All right, well, let's begin. Welcome, friends, to today's breakout session. It's Assistive Technology Apps, Extensions, and Resources for Readers and Writers of All Ages. Our presenter today is Kate Tingley from Prior Lake. My name is Wendy Wolf, and I'm the coordinator for Concordia University's Master's in Education and Educational Technology, and I'll be your host for this session. If you have questions for Kate or comments about this session, please add them in the chat box. I'll be monitoring that chat box throughout the session. And when asking a question, please include your name and organization, your school. As a reminder, the session is being recorded and will be able to be played, paused, and rewound at your own speed. So you can check the recording sessions to see this later today, and access will be available for 1 year. Kate Tingley is a K-5 library media specialist in Prior Lake who blogs, pushes books, and loves integration with technology and students. She has been in the business of educating children for over 24 years and has her master's in curriculum and instruction, K-6 Minnesota classroom license, and K-12 Minnesota certification. She is a former ISTE, FETC, TIES, ITEM, and district camp presenter and local Coder Dojo. She was a Google certified teacher and is Common Sense Educational Ambassador and Seesaw certified educator. She has 3 very tall and fun sons, 2 senior pet poodles, and a husband she met of all places on the computer in 1988, no less. With that, I am happy to introduce Kate. You can access the presentation at the bit.ly link in the chat. And Kate, please share your presentation with us.
Wow, thank you, Wendy. Quite the intro. I appreciate that. Welcome, everybody, to Assistive Technology Apps, Extensions, and Resources. I am going to be providing you with many resources you can use for readers and writers of all ages. And I designed the slideshow with some of my all-time favorite resources. And you can feel free to go back and access the slideshow anytime. I hope for you is that you find one that you will be able to use with your students this fall. Wendy mentioned a little bit about my tech history. I think we all have a tech timeline. This helps give you the big picture of how I started on my technology journal, and it went way back in 1987, my long time ago. I was a high school newspaper editor, and back then we had to use DOS disk boot ups for the computers. That was my first interaction with a computer. I did some technology things in my first teaching position in St. Peter, Minnesota. And at the time, one of my students was a Gustavus, his dad was a Gustavus professor. And the only way we could have internet access way back in the day was through a university. And so he got me hooked up with making my first website using HTML. And as you progress on my timeline, of course, there's a few kids, as Wendy mentioned earlier in my intro, in amongst my professional technology timeline. Leads us to today. If you look at the 2016, I attended the FETC conference, which was in Florida. It is an amazing EdTech conference, if you ever have the opportunity to attend. And one of the sessions that I attended was hosted by Nicole Feeney, and she is an assistive technology specialist. And I went for professional reasons, but I also went for personal reasons too, because one of those very tall sons has a learning difference in reading and writing. And when I sat down at Nicole Feeney's presentation and I heard the resources that she had to share, I was blown away. So I'm hoping to share some of those resources that I discovered on my journey since 2016, because it has definitely become a passion of mine since then. That leads me to talking a little bit about Universal Design for Learning. Again, I have a resource for you here. Understood.org is an incredible resource. When we're thinking about UDL for our students, information is often presented in multiple ways so that it can best reach the needs of our students. It encourages teachers to use different formats, including oral presentations, group projects, and looks for different ways to keep students motivated and engaged. And one of the tools that I'm going to talk about, I'm using right now, I don't know if you can see my subtitles, but that is available in PowerPoint, and Google Slides does have it too. They do have it too, and I'll show you how to get to that. So in a UDL classroom, materials are accessible for all types of learners. I want to introduce you to Mushi. Mushi was a student in Mr. Burton's English class in 2013. He had to give a speech as a requirement for his class. That might not be an obstacle for some, but it definitely was an obstacle for Mushi because Mushi had a stammer and still does. The speech was a mountain for him. His teacher happened to watch a movie about the king with a stammer, and it gave him an idea. Let's listen to see what that idea was and what happened to Mushi as a result of his teacher finding this idea.
Nice and loud, nice and proud. Can we, right, one thing, and it's only because I watched the King's Speech quite recently, all right?
Okay.
One thing he does, right, when the, because it's a very similar thing to you, in that you just can't get the words out. But what, one thing he does do is he makes him listen to some music, right? And then when he's listening to the music, gets him to do it again.
Okay.
So you, have you got your phone with you?
No.
Awesome. Right, just plug it into mine. I'll put you some awful music on.
Oh, yes.
Right? Right, you ready?
No, yes, sir.
There?
Okay, that's right.
Go for it. One, two, three.
The moment when, after many years of hard work and a long voyage,
is it too loud? Loud.
That I own this is the same moment when the trees unloose their soft arm from around you, the birds take back their language, the cliffs
fissure,
the cliffs fissure and collapse, the air moves back from you like a wave and you can't breathe.
What? Pause.
No,
pause.
Carry on. No, the whisper, you own nothing. You were a visitor time after time, climbing the hill, planting the flag, proclaiming we never belong to you. You never found us, it was always the other way round.
That's insane.
Yes, sir.
Did that feel good?
Did it sound, yes.
Do you feel confident?
That's yes.
Can I go get Miss Lee? Stay there. Good lad. Can I borrow you, Miss Lee, for a second? Right, our poet extraordinaire, right? You ready?
Yeah. When the trees unloose their soft arms from around you, the birds take back their language, the cliffs fissure and collapse, the air moves back from you like a wave and you can't breathe. You never found us, it was always the other way around.
What an unbelievable thing that is.
Must be one of the best things in your life, actually, as well. For the first time.
I genuinely didn't think it would work, but amazingly it did.
There was one of you sitting here that actually didn't hated it in year seven because, unfortunately, some people bullied him. And he wanted to leave. And in year seven, he had an attendance of about 34% because he didn't have a voice then. And he's got one now. So, Musharraf, where are you? This is ticking a lot, but he wanted to show just what we've and you've done for him.
Oh, damn. Come on.
I want to thank you. I want to thank you today for letting me speak in front of all of you. I want to especially thank Mr. Burton for helping me overcome my stammer. The school has helped me improve so much that I do not have enough words to tell you all how. I really am going to miss the school, the teachers, the students, and just the whole high school environment. It's good. I don't have a dream to work at a call center, or else I would be fired the same day. I really want to thank you all for listening, and I hope the best for all of you. To all my fellow students and teachers.
That teacher right there said, "You don't know how proud I am of you." Pretty powerful message of how one teacher can impact his students to help him overcome a huge barrier for him. One thing about assistive technology is that it's compensatory and it's not remedial. It's to help in an area where the student is struggling, but it's not in place of remedial instruction. This video, if you're unfamiliar with assistive technology, does a great job of explaining it a little bit more in detail, and it comes right from our great state of Minnesota.
We all like to do things like color and read and use a computer. It's how we play, learn, work, and get things done. But when a disability makes it hard to do something we'd like to do, we need a little help. Luckily, there's a solution. Welcome to Simply Said, Understanding Assistive Technology. Assistive technology, or AT, is anything that helps you do something you couldn't do otherwise, like walk, run, communicate, and more. These helpful tools can be as simple as a foam grip that makes it possible for a child to grasp a crayon and create art, as common as glasses that make it possible for a student to read and learn, or as sophisticated as software that makes it possible for an employee to convert their spoken word to text on a computer screen and succeed. Whether you're young or old, male or female, whether you've had a disability from birth or developed one over the years, AT can help. Finding AT is easier than you might think. Huh. Every state has an Assistive Technology Act program to help you find AT. In Minnesota, it's called the STAR program. You can find it at starprogram.state.mn.us. To find a program like STAR in another state, check out the Association of Assistive Technology Act programs at ataporg.org. There are also many AT centers, including PACER's Simon Technology Center, that you can find at pacer.org/STC. The STC's consultants help you explore the numerous technology options available. Its lending library lets you try different kinds of AT to discover what works best for you. So now you know a little bit about AT. It helps you do something that you couldn't do without it. And it's available in every state. This has been Simply Said, Understanding Assistive Technology.
One thing when we think of technology with our students, I've always been excited about technology and the use of technology with students. If you remember back to my tech timeline, I met my husband for the first time using technology in 1988, pre-internet. Shared computer system between both college campuses, that's what connected us initially. And when I was a young educator, at first I would be into finding cool tools and thinking of ways that I can use them with my group of fourth graders. and I get excited about the new updates and features, and I would sometimes forget to put the skills or the students' needs first. And along this journey, I feel strongly that according to the set framework, as Joy Zavala referenced, the student has to always come first. What are the needs of the student? What is the environment that the student is working in? What task does the student need to complete? And then what tool will help the student complete that particular task? So when we use AT with students, it has to be for the right skill in the right environment in completing a desired task. And I do have links for you right here to go back if you want to reference the SET framework a little bit more to get a better understanding. In this particular presentation, I know different schools use different technology tools. So I have broken it down into iPad apps, G Suite, Google extensions and apps, and also the Microsoft Suite learning tools. So depending on what your school district uses, what you have available for your students, hopefully you can zero in on that particular operating system and it can help you find some AT tools for your students. So the first thing we are going to talk about is AT tools with reading. I had to begin the presentation with the tools that first introduced me to AT and Immersive Reader. I had referenced Nicole Sweeney's presentation in the FETC conference. I was sitting in her conference and she mentioned Bookshare, which I had not heard of, and then the two apps here, VoiceStream and Go Read. And at the time I was looking as a media specialist ways to help my students in the computer lab particularly read the content on the screen, even though they may not be at that particular reading level, but they could understand the reading level. And I also had a personal interest with my son in his reading fluency. I began with the skill of wanting him to be able to read books that his peers were reading, because I knew that he could comprehend grade level text, but he could not decode grade level text. So as a mother and a teacher, I knew how important it was for him to hear the grade level vocabulary within the text. And I thought, how do I bridge that gap? And when I was sitting in Nicole Feeney's presentation, a light bulb went off and she put that light bulb there. Bookshare is a free resource if you have a print disability, and reading disability does qualify you for it as well. It has so many Audible books on there that help bridge that gap for our learners so that they can hear what they're reading. And when you combine it for VoiceStream and Go Read, then it gives you an immersive reader experience. And I'll share what immersive reader is as well. So if you have a print disability, Bookshare is available for free. Now, speaking about Immersive Reader, back in 2016, using Bookshare and a combination of the apps that you saw was the only way that I knew that Immersive Reader existed. And since 2016, the Immersive Reader capability has exploded and is many times embedded into applications that we're using every single day, and you may not know it. So hopefully I will be able to share that with you, which applications already have Immersive Reader in it. So Immersive Reader is just that. It gives the reader an immersive experience when reading. They can see the text, they can hear it, and they can follow along. And the Immersive Reader options, lots of times, are there for us to change the font size. We can change the color of the font, whatever works best for our visual senses. It can split up the words in syllables. It can highlight parts of speech, choose between two different fonts that work best for us. And of course, it reads the text out loud. You can change the rate of the text, and you can many times change the voice that you hear the text being read. I want to talk a little bit, I told you about Microsoft Immersive Reader, because they have definitely upped their game when thinking about AT tools for students. I back in the day on my tech timeline, used Microsoft about 100% of the time. Google came out, the collaborative feature within Google's Forms, Docs, so forth, kind of made the switch. And now I'm going back a little bit to Microsoft. And one of the reasons is the accessibility built into their tools. It's pretty amazing. When you go back into this slideshow, and I know Wendy posted the link to the bit.ly, if you have a device and you can get to that bit.ly now, that would be so beneficial, because each of these graphics, I posted a link to tell you a little bit about which one of these Microsoft tools have Immersive Reader, and then actually what the tools do. OneNote is a Microsoft tool taking note, which is amazing. You can organize in different folders. Office Lens is an OCR, optical recognition tool. So you can take a picture, and it's free, by the way, of just about anything if you get it on your phone, and it will upload it, save it, and then it has the built-in Immersive Reader right within the tool. So if you want it to be read aloud to you, you have that capability, which is amazing. Word also has the Immersive Reader built in, and Microsoft Edge, which is its browser, has Immersive Reader built right into the browser. So again, I put links to each one of these tools. They're free to reference, and I have the accessibility tutorial from Microsoft here that was just updated June 29th. So I highly, highly, if your school uses Microsoft tools and learning tools, to go back into the presentation and see what you can find. I put Flipgrid on here. We're all using Flipgrid in Best Prep, which is an amazing tool. Flipgrid, you know, started out as its own independent company right here in Minneapolis, and then Microsoft acquired it. Well, as you saw, Microsoft has Immersive Reader in the majority of its learning tools. An Immersive Reader feature is in Flipgrid as well. It includes closed captions, the Immersive Reader feature, student-generated transcripts, scripts, text with audio, an amazing feature that they're putting right into Flipgrid, which is what a lot of teachers are familiar with that may not even know that it exists within the application. So let's talk about the iPad apps. One thing you can do for that accessibility for print and getting it to speech is right in the settings option of our iOS devices. And along with Bookshare, can be an app in iPad. There is also a Learning Ally, which is like Bookshare, but you have to pay for the service. But so many textbooks, books, audiobooks are there, but it takes it beyond just the audiobooks, and it gives you the immersive reading experience where you're actually seeing the text on the page, which I think is so beneficial. And then it will highlight the text. As you're hearing the word, it highlights the word on the page as well. So again, I have a link for Learning Ally right there for you to check out. And I am going to leave plenty of time for questions and time for you to explore which one of these tools you think would work best. A little bit later, I'm going to ask you to think about one student that you think may benefit from just one of these AT tools. And I know I'm going to present you with many different tools, but if you can just pick one that you think you know would be beneficial for that student, that's a great place to start. I posted this graphic because it comes from Call Scotland, from the University of Edinburgh, and they have spent a lot of time researching iPad apps for kids that might have a learning disability in reading or writing. And I love the wheel because it breaks it down. Okay, what skill are you looking for? And then it gives you the examples of apps that you might want to use. Again, I linked this graphic right here. So if you're following along with me and you want to click the graphic, I do know that they updated it recently as well. It'll give you some great ideas for AT tools with our students. Now let's switch a little bit to Google applications. two Google extensions right now that I have on my browser, although you can't see it because I'm using PowerPoint, are Speak It and Read Aloud. They are free Google extensions. A lot of times when we work with Google applications, you know, you go into the Google Store or the App Store, and you can install the extension, and it then will appear on your browser. And I can demonstrate this during question and answer time, but basically you highlight any text on your computer screen, you highlight it, and then you press play, and it will read it for you. So again, my dilemma in the computer lab with all of my students of fourth graders, some of them that perhaps weren't at a fourth grade reading level, but the text on the page was, I knew they could comprehend it. I could install Speak It as an extension, and they would be able to hear the text read aloud. I have Speechify on there as well. And then these two links I love, more apps and extensions related to Google. And then I have Google's accessibility webpage there that they talk all about AT. Speaking of Google, those of us that might have Chromebooks, I have a page that was put together by Mike Murata. He is an AT guru, in my opinion. I follow him on Twitter. He has the latest and greatest tools out there that he has found helpful when working with his teachers and his students. So again, I link this for you, and I put a link to Mike Murata's website here. Read and Write. I am going to skip this video for now, but I've left it in here so that you can go back and look at it to see what Read and Write is. It is a Google Chrome extension as well, a little bit more robust than the two Speak It that I mentioned. They do have a free version, but they also have a paid version too. And most, I should have mentioned this, most of the apps and extensions I share with you will be available for free. So this is our, his name happens to be Mike too, Microsoft 365 education connection person, the go-to person, and he's going to tell us a little bit about the tools that you saw earlier.
Hi, I'm Mike. Today, I'm going to demonstrate how you can improve reading skills with Microsoft Learning Tools. To get started, go to office.com and sign into your Office 365 education account. Click on Word to open a Word document, and now go to the View tab and click on the Immersive Reader. You'll see all of the page is reducing distractions, and I can really focus on the text. When you press the Play button,
the Amazon rainforest,
you hear the text read aloud, and you see the words highlighted, you can easily follow along. You can increase and decrease voice speed really easily. You can increase the font size. You can also increase the spacing, which is a proven technique to help reduce visual crowding. You also can click on a page color that gives better contrast and can make it easier to see the letters. Now you can turn the syllables on as well and break them down with a single click. I can highlight the different parts of speech like nouns, verbs, adjectives, and adverbs. Now reading rulers are something that teachers have used for a long time for focus. And with a single click here, I can turn on line focus and really give that extra focus for students. With the picture dictionary, I can click on a single word and see a picture of that and also play it back to have that multi-sensory processing, a great tool for reading comprehension. So learning tools are available in OneNote, Outlook, Office Lens, and Edge as part of Office 365 in Education, which is free for you teachers and students. Go check it out.
Pretty amazing tools Microsoft has for us. I wanted to share that with you because he demonstrated what Immersive Reader is and across the different platforms, that whether it's iOS, whether it's Google or Microsoft, that's exactly what Microsoft or Immersive Reader looks like. So I added this graphic too. Mike produced this. He presented this at ISTEAM 2019. I happened to see him, and it gives you the task that you might want to have the particular application perform, and then it tells you which application does that. And you can see they added Flipgrid there as well. So another handy tool to go back to. One thing you'll notice that I'm doing is I'm doing the subtitles and the dictation within PowerPoint, hoping to model that accessibility tool for you. Google does have that option as well, although I have found that the dictation within PowerPoint is a little crisper and converts my speech to text a little bit more accurately.
Excuse me, Kate?
Yes.
We have a question, and it's
sure.
What is the difference between Speak It and Read Aloud for Google? Would you like me to remind you of that when we get to Q&A, or would you like to address that now?
Sure, let's do that during Q&A.
Okay, I'll hang on to it. Thank you.
Thank you. So here are some of the other resources that I have for you if you want to take a deep dive. I added a couple more there to my Google slideshow, so if you're following along with me. Some of them are brand new. I talked to Mike that you saw on the previous video, and he said be sure to share with your educators attending the conference these resources as well. So the ebooks that we talked about and how that we can get Audible or ebooks for our students. I mentioned Bookshare, which is a free platform if you have a print disability. Learning Ally is similar, but there is a fee to Learning Ally. It's amazing. I'm sure you've heard several of these as well, so I put them on there for you to go back in reference at your own time. I also have some reading resources here available for you to check out. I don't know if you've heard of the ReWordify website, but the ReWordify website is you can take text, you paste it into the website, and it will make the text a little bit more understanding, changing some of the vocabulary, more understandable. And that's not a separate app, it is a website itself. So let's go into writing. I know I'm going fast. I want to leave some time to explore and questions too. There's just so much to share with you. Assistive technology tools in writing applications. The first I want to share with you are the iPad apps. I have these all linked, so it will take you to the app if you want to learn more about it. My son uses CoWriter. He loves it. It does word prediction for him. It gives him suggestions. It's an amazing tool to help with his learning difference. These two at the bottom are optical character recognition. We're a little bit like Office Lens by Microsoft, which is free. You can take a picture of whatever it is. This one happens to be, I believe, PDFs, yes. And then it will convert it to speech for us. Pretty cool. So Google Applications, G Suite, I have three here that you might want to take a look at. I will tell you the ones that I put on the top of the screens usually, like here, are the ones that are my favorites or that I've used the most. This is something that's coming out that I threw in here that is fairly new. It's within Word, and the similarity checker can identify and help writers with originality in their writing, and then also learn more about appropriate attribution through tools that facilitate the easy insertion of relevant citations, which is huge. So this can aid our writers in focusing less on the mechanics of writing and more on the content that they want to write. With the mechanics of citations taken care of, the students are freed up to focus on their writing, and their reader can tell what material originates with them. And people get credit for what does not originate with our students. So if you have a moment, check that out. I do want to bring up some writing resources that I've found. And again, this Amazon one is a little bit older, but sometimes you know, with all our home devices that we have, Alexa, Echo, there are ways that our learners could use them at home to help them. And so I left this article there. The other two, again, understood.org is one of my favorite resources. And I want to share this resource too with you from Augsburg University, right here in Minnesota. They have a very robust assistive technology resource waiting for you to discover. It is absolutely incredible. Additional resources that I have there as well. I put a few Twitter chats because as soon as I went to Nicole Feeney's presentation, I followed her on Twitter. I followed Mike, I followed Jamie, and they are experts. I am not an expert. I'm just a teacher and a parent trying to find what best fits my son and my learners at school. And so I'm always learning. And I am hopeful that after today's presentation, you'll find at least one tool that you can use within your school's platform to aid other students. Because as we all know, when you hide your voice, you rob the world of your creativity. This was taken from a Flipgrid professional development conference that I attended years ago. And Flipgrid has really amplified our ability to use and hear student voices. Now, if you remember at the beginning of my presentation, Mushi, what is he doing now? Let's take a look. Here he is. I found this video June 27, 2020. And he has become a professional speaker. Let's take a listen. This is his thank you to all the people that helped him.
What is going on, guys? And welcome to today's little video about, I just want to basically say thank you. Now, 2 days ago, the final episode of Educating Yorkshire Ed on Channel 4, and it's been absolutely crazy because you guys have been sending me so many messages on Twitter, on Snapchat, on Insta. I've been having emails. Pretty much everywhere I've been receiving some sort of recognition for what I did and for what I achieved. And I just wanted to say a massive thank you to every single person out there who has sent me a message. I think one of the main reasons I went onto the show itself was to just basically show that no matter what adversity you face, you can overcome it with the right mindset and having the support from the right people. And I feel I was just really fortunate that I had a teacher like Mr. Burton who was there to support me, and also quite a few other teachers who were there supporting me. And it's just overwhelming to see that a moment in which I was able to partially get my words out, I was able to actually feel that feeling of knowing that I had a voice. And all I can say is from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much to everyone. Like, honestly, I would not be here on this journey of inspiring and motivating if you guys didn't take in the story that I was basically on.
So pretty powerful.
It's hard to
He was able to share his voice and his teacher helped him find his voice. Dave Waddle was in the 1972 Olympics in Germany. And I have a little homework for you. This is a video that I hope that you come back to and watch on your own time. Something about him is he suffered from tendonitis and he didn't get to prepare as well as he had hoped. And he is pretty far behind. In fact, 1972, he's the runner here with the baseball cap. You wouldn't see that today. But it talks about his journey, how he feels so behind. And if you watch the video, you're going to see what happens to him. And I'll give you a little peek into what happens. But he starts from behind, and he comes, and he catches up to the pack. And he has captions on the video telling what he's thinking as he's running the race. And when he starts to come up to the pack, to get closer to the pack, he says, okay, if I can just regain contact with the pack and stay there, I will be good. And what ends up happening, you'll have to watch it to find out. But my hope for all of us is that by providing AT for our students, we can help them regain contact with the pack and to help find their voice. Thank you. I would like to answer questions. And in doing so, something that you can think about right now is think of a student maybe that you had last year. What skill do they need help and where they could most benefit from having the option of having assistive technology? If you are using iPads, go to the iPad section on my presentation. Chromebooks, go to the Google section. If you're using Microsoft, which I know there are some people, go to the Microsoft section of my presentation and explore, and hopefully you'll find a tool. I am going to stop sharing right now so that I can see all of you and see if you have any questions, and I will get it set up so that I can show you speak it and you can actually see the difference here. Any questions?
Okay, Christine is asking, are there any differences?
Hello?
Christine, do you want to unmute and just ask your question?
Oh, sure. I was just curious if there were any of the tools that you think would be particularly helpful for multilingual students who maybe are new to the language and a few, you know, in terms of grade level, a few grade levels behind, and assistive in reading or writing.
Okay, so let me think. I'm going to go back to my presentation here. Because I have been noticing that multiple languages are available within the Immersive Reader tool. So a lot of those tools that I shared with you, you can select your language. Mm-hmm. Other than that, I can do a little resource or some dig into my files off the top of my head. I would have to do a little research. Would you be able to, do you want to either find me on Twitter, or I can give you my email address so I can, which would you prefer?
Email.
Okay. I will type it in the chat.
I was thinking the same thing about multilingual, and I was looking at Speak It versus Read Aloud. And the Speak It, you have the option of changing the language, but it really just changes the accent of the reader. They're still reading it in English. It doesn't translate it. I was hopeful that it maybe would, but. Yeah, you can set it to a different language, but it's really just the different dialect. It doesn't translate it.
Do you have access to the Microsoft tools?
I can check. I haven't tried them yet.
Because I have found that I started using Speak It and Read 'Em Right, but because they were kind of a separate extension and an add-on, they didn't work quite as slick as the embedded tools within the Microsoft learning tools. And I'm just gonna look here. So where you see Immersive Reader, you can choose your languages within the Microsoft tools. I think they might have 55 languages. I would start with them. We use Google products in our district, but technically we're not a G Suite school. But we also have Microsoft products that a lot of teachers don't know that they are even there, or we haven't had a lot of PD on them, which is interesting because if they buy the suite at a district level, they're free for all of us to use. So that might be something to look at. I don't work for any of them, Google or Microsoft. I've just been trying to find the ones that work the best. The other thing is, I'm wondering if Office Lens has the translator option.
Okay, Kate, as you check that, I just want to remind we have 3 minutes left and we're still, P. Gilligan has added to the question of the difference between Speak It and Read Aloud. Are they the same thing, just different apps?
Well, Read Aloud and Speak It, I would say the free version of Read Aloud is a little bit similar, probably a little more robust. If you can go back and watch that video, it shares it. The paid version of Read Aloud is definitely, has many, many more features than Speak It. So Speak It, I can just show you very quickly here. I don't know if it will work within my screen share, is an extension. You can see that I have I have all of them up here that I mentioned. I have Read and Write, I have the Speak It, and I have the other one. So when I'm using it, if I click on it first.
Languages and products supported by Immersive Reader. These are the languages currently supported by Immersive Reader. Choose your.
So it's pretty basic. I don't have the option within Speak It right here because it's the free version that I can change the size of the font right here. But if you see here, it says select your language.
Languages and products supported by Immersive Reader.
It's reading on the
languages
page.
Currently supported by
So let's try. Let me see if it will let me do the other one here. This is the select your language in the Microsoft tools that are supported within Immersive Reader itself. So whether it's Flipgrid, whether it's Word, whatever it is, these are the languages that you can choose from. Read and Write, you'll see this is the free version again. A toolbox appears for Read and Write. Oh, and now see it's asking me to log in, whereas the Speak It did not ask. You can't see it because it's on my other screen, but the Speak It one did not ask me to log in. So it was a little bit more, and if I press play, it might have a lag because it's logging me in.
Languages and products supported by Immersive Reader. Word for the Web OneNote 2016, Word 2006.
So that's the Read and Write. So you saw the Speak It and then the Read and Write version. And then of course the Read and Write paid version would be even more robust.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Kate. It is 10 o'clock. Thanks for a great session. Everybody, if you want to give Kate an applause, you can under the little icon of with participation that would show up on your video. Thank you, participants, for joining our session today. We hope that you've found some great tools that will help your learners as well. Participants, please remember to complete the session survey that's found on our survey widget. And the session will again be viewable in the recorded sessions widget later today. So you'll be able to pause, play, and rewind as desired. We invite you at this time to head to your next scheduled event. And we thank you again, Kate, for sharing your information and your resources. They're really inspiring. And we hope everybody has a great day.